Today we are doing Music with the Minister. So it's been a couple of months because we had it on Easter, so we didn't do Music with the Minister. So we are on a first Sunday today, so we are doing Music with the Minister. If you haven't been here before, this is where I take a current Christian song and kind of dissect the lyrics of it and kind of walk through it with you of what the song is teaching. Now, in the sake of diversity, all right, I have chosen a country song today. Now, again, I have people disagree with me going, this isn't really country. He just has some tang in his voice or ting or whatever you call it. Is it tang? Twang, that's what it is. I don't listen to country music. I don't like country music. It's not my thing, as you all know. But for the sake of diversity today, we are listening to a song called Less of Me by Zach Williams. And I consider him to be a Christian country type style artist. And so it's not my cup of tea of music, but I have listened to the song a lot this week, and it's actually grown on me, and now I love country music. No, I don't. Okay. No, I still hate it. But we are listening to it today. So we give you a well verse, so we give you rap sometimes, we give you country, pop, whatever it is. Now, here's the thing. Before we listen to the song, we're going to talk a little bit before we get there, because I need to set up kind of the song by talking about personalities. Okay? So here's the thing about us. Is we all have unique personalities to us, and within our personalities, we have typically three different areas of our personality and different traits that they translate into. So to cover those real quick, let me just hit on them. The first one is you have positive traits. So all of us have some personality traits that are a positive to the world around us, and so these are the ones that we like to talk about. These are the ones we're kind of proud of that we'll say, yeah, this is what I do well. For instance, here's a couple of them I've learned about myself over the years. Number one, people like the personality trait of me of I'm stable. I'm always the same. Rarely do I have fluctuations of up or down or anything. I'm a stable person. I've been here 15 years, and you know that about me. I'm just like clockwork, and I'm stable. That's a good thing of mine. The other personality trait that's good of mine, which is I can make the complex understandable, is the other thing I've learned from people is they go, you take hard topics at times and you make it very easy to understand, and you just make the complex understandable. So those are two personality traits that are positive traits of mine. We also all have these, which are negative traits, okay? We have negative things about our personalities that don't do necessarily good to the surrounding environment around us. And since I'm up here on stage, I have to share a couple of these. So these are a couple of them that I've learned over time that are negative ones of mine. One of mine is I lack sensitivity, okay? So I have realized this over time. If you were just in Sunday school class with me and heard my conversation with my mother, you understand this. But I lack sensitivity, which is not a positive thing. That's not necessarily a good thing. It's a negative trait of mine. It comes from my family upbringing. We're kind of all that way. And here's the other thing that you know that's a negative trait you have. You try to come up with excuses to justify why you have them. So that's why I blame it on my family, because I don't want to take total ownership of it because it's a negative trait, all right? So that is one of them. The other thing that I have that's a negative one is I've kind of figured this one out. I'm kind of a loner in the sense of I don't need people around me. I don't need people's approval. I don't need anything like that. And I'm kind of a loner. And you might go, that's not all that. Well, in my case, it is. Because what I have found, that personality trait then leads to potential arrogance. And you have to fight with arrogance all the time because I just don't need other people. And I can do everything myself, or I can find all the answers myself. And that's not a positive thing. So that's actually a negative trait to my personality that I'm not proud of either. But I've realized that over time. Now, there's a third set of traits that we don't usually talk about. I call them double-edged traits, and what I mean by that is you can swing them one way, and they can be a positive. You can swing them the other way, the exact same trait, and they can be a negative. So they can be used for good, and they can be used for bad. Two of them that I have, number one is I'm a good debater. So if I'm using that for good, I can help people understand things and walk them through questions and stuff like that in a very systematic way to help people come to understanding, which is positive. At the same time, I can use it to bury people in a debate if I want to, which is not a positive way of using it. All right. The other one I have is I don't value tradition. On the positive side of that is I do not get stuck in saying this is how it's always been done, so it has to be done this way, because I don't value tradition and I don't care what's happened in the past, so that doesn't matter. So it allows me to look at things uniquely every time and freshly. At the same time, it also makes me devalue things that other people hold that are important, and it becomes a negative thing, where I just go, there's no reason not to bring some value to that. There's no reason to ignore that, but I just do at times, which hurts other people. And so those are those double-edged ones that can be swung one way for good, swung the other way for bad. Now, to be being honest about our personality traits, though, is very important for us to actually understand how we interact with the world and how we allow God to actually change us from the inside out. To being honest about our personality traits, about what our positives are, what our negatives are, and what our double-edged traits are, is essential for us to grow in our relationship with God. Romans chapter 12 says this, because of the privilege and the authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think that you are better than you really are. Okay? Don't think that you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves. Measuring yourselves by the grace that God has given us. You see, being honest about who we are allows us to allow God's Spirit to start transforming us. Because if we're not honest about who we are, then we do not allow the Spirit to transform us from the inside out because we fight it constantly, okay? So it's very important that we are honest about who we are and what our personalities are, the good, the bad, and the in-between. So we're going to listen to a song called Less of Me. And as you're watching this, just understand the words, because the first one's a lyric video. The words to the song are in all the signs that we'll zoom in on. So just be looking for the signs in each of the different shots, and it will be the words to the song. All right? Chuck, go ahead. Guy, he looks totally country. He's got a beard and a hat.
Oh, I have days to lose the fight. Try my best, but just don't get it right. Where I talk a talk that I don't walk and miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. But I just can't see past myself. Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness. Like, yeah, there's no denying I have changed. I've been saved from who I used to be. But even at my best, I must confess I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, to feed the beggar on the street, love to be your hands and feet, little less lightning.
Little less like me. Now, real quick, just let me just get a vote. How many of you consider that at least country-ish? Oh, okay. All right. So I was right. So good. All right. That makes me feel better now. So let's carry on this morning. So what we're going to do now is we're just going to go through the lyrics here. We're going to walk through it. I've got some things to talk about it and some highlights just to point out to you. So here's how the song starts. It says this. Oh, I have days I lose the fight. I try my best but just don't get it right. All right, and I think he's describing something most of us feel on a regular basis, which is that feeling of you try to do what's right, you try to do your best in the day, and you get to the end of the day and just go, man, I failed again. Okay, I still didn't get it right. I just didn't live up to the standards that I wish I had. And he's kind of expressing that. The Apostle Paul in Romans 7, he says it like this. He says, I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyways. And so even the Apostle Paul, the guy who starts the entire church, the Gentile church, and that's what we all have sprung off of, even he's kind of having that same feeling, which is, I want to do what's right every day, and it just doesn't seem like I can ever get it down. Like, I just can never seem to get my life together to do it the way I want to do it. And so he's expressing that. It goes on, it says this, well, I talk a talk, that I don't walk and miss the moments right before my eyes. And you get a sense of a guy just being honest here. And what he's being honest about is most of the time I fail. Most of the time I don't get it right. And what you're seeing here is a guy that's just going, I'm a flawed human. I'm a flawed person. I can't put it all together. And we're all at that same place probably again where we just have daily regrets where we sit there and go, I say I'm one thing, I say this is how I choose to live, but yet I miss moment after moment after moment of where I could do different things differently, where I could do things I know I should have that I didn't. And he goes on to say what some of those are. He says this, somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held. And so he's kind of giving some descriptions of going, I pass by people all the time. People I know I could have helped, I don't do it. People, I probably just need someone to sit with them and hold their hand for a little bit, just let them know I care and that they're loved, and I just don't do it. And what he does next in the song is this. He identifies what that core issue is. Why do we fail so much to help the people we can help, to spend the time with the people we should spend time with, to be the person we say we want to be? Why do we fail? And he says this. He says, when I just can't see past myself. And what he identifies here is this. The root problem that stops us from being who we know we should be and who Christ wants us to be as Christians, the root problem always comes back to selfishness. It comes back to not being able to see past ourselves and our own desires and the things happening in our lives, not being able to see past that. Because of that selfishness, I picked out three scriptures here I want to read with you. It makes these scriptures very difficult to hear and actually think you can implement them in your life because of selfishness. Let me just read these to you. Philippians 2:3, it says this, don't be selfish, don't try to impress others, be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. That's hard, is it not? Like, that's a tough teaching. Now, the reason as we go through these three, there's more scriptures like this, the reason I think it's a continual message in the New Testament is because God knows who we are. And he knows we need to hear these things repetitively time and time again. In 1 Corinthians, it says this, don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. What? Okay, again, not an easy thing to do, all right? Don't be concerned about your own good, but for the good of others. Put them first. That is not easy because we are selfish people. In Romans 15, 1 through 3, it says this, we must not just please ourselves, we should help others do what is right and build them up in the Lord. For even Christ didn't live to please himself. Okay, so he just starts off, we must not just please ourselves. Again, our culture tells us that's what everything's about. Everything's about you being happy, about you finding ways to make yourself happy and to be happy in your life. So our culture tells us the direct opposite message that God tells us of how we are supposed to live our lives. Therefore, it's very hard for us to hear those passages and go, yeah, I can accomplish that, because it's so foreign to everything else we hear. Now, the next part of the song, which is the main chunk of the song, this is an incredible prayer if you just read it as a prayer. So here's what he says in the next part of the song. He says, oh Lord, help me. So he goes through, I fail. I've never seen anybody able to get it right. I wish I would do more. I pass by circumstances that I could help and I don't. I pass by people I know that are hurting and I don't take the time to actually let them know I care. And then he goes into, let me give you some of the solution. He says, oh Lord, help me. And what I want you to understand here is this: everything starts here. All transformation in your life starts with going to God. You cannot do it on your own. And what I mean by that is this: you can train yourself to get rid of some of your bad behaviors. So some of my bad personality traits, I can train myself to deceive people that those aren't my negative traits. I can deceive people by removing them so you don't see them publicly. You can change some of your outward appearance and your behaviors. The problem is this: you cannot actually train yourself to change your negative personality traits at the core about who you are. You can cover them up. You can hide them from people. You can get better from showing them to people. But what happens inside here and here is a core part of who you are, and you can't change that on your own. That only happens through the transformation that Christ can bring to your life. And so Zach Williams here, he calls on, he says, oh Lord, help me be. So he's starting off going, I realize I have to go to God first, because I can change what it looks like to the outside world, but the core is still the core. And the only way that's ever going to change is I allow Christ in. Now he goes on with this. Now he gives a list of things. He says, oh Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace. And what most of these come from is Galatians chapter 5, the fruits of the Spirit, which is where Paul comes out and he writes and he says, if you allow God's Spirit into your life, these are some of the traits that you will start to see transforming inside you and become more prominent in your life. And he starts going through a list of, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Zach throws a few more in here. But what he's saying is this: God, I want to be more like these traits, a little more like this in my life. So where I want to spend a little time here is go through each of those real quick and kind of define those for you from a Christian perspective. What do those words mean? What are those traits in your life? So let me go through them. The first one he brings up is mercy. So what is mercy? Mercy would be this: a willingness not to hold a person's negative actions against them. So mercy is, Christy has done something to me, and I choose not to hold that against her. I just choose to let it go, and I choose to go, that's fine. It was just something that happened, not a big deal. That is mercy. Would I be justified in responding in a way? Sure, I could be justified, and I could go back and attack, but mercy is, no, I'm just going to pull back, and I'm just going to let that go, and it's not that big of a deal. That is mercy. And he's going, I want a little bit more of that in my life. The next one is kindness. And the way I describe kindness is this: looking for ways to lift the spirits of others, okay? Looking for ways to lift the spirits of others. When you see people feeling down or gloomy or whatever, finding a way to just kind of lift their spirits up, being proactive about that, that's kindness. He brings up goodness. The way I describe goodness is this: proactively looking to be helpful to others. There's a key word here, proactively, okay? Not just when it's so obvious, gotta help. It's proactively having eyes that you're looking around going, how can I help other people? That would be goodness here, which is you're proactively looking for ways to be helpful to other people. It brings up love. And the definition of love is this: to put someone else's good before your own. That's love. Okay, our culture tells us it's all sorts of other things. Love is simply this: I look to put someone else's good above my own. So I'm going to do what I can to better them in spite of myself. That's love. That's true love. That's what Christ did for us. That is pure love. Next one he brings up is faith. And the way I would describe faith is this: trusting God when you can't see any benefits. That would be faith, which is you want to be a little bit more like that, that even though you know what you're supposed to do, but you can't see any benefit to it, you still do it because you know God asked you to do it. That's how I would describe faith. The last two he brings up patience. Patience is this, being able to control your temper without complaining. All right? Most of us could use this one a little bit more, right? Being able to control our tempers without complaining, without whining about it. That's patience. And peace is this, helping others control their temper without complaining. Okay? So you have patience, which is about you. Bringing peace is helping tone other people back. So an example of this is, we were playing ball here on Tuesday or Thursday, I don't know which day it was. One of the guys here, he gets very emotional in his basketball playing. So he's very vocal, he gets into the game, he's there. But when he's losing or his teammates are not performing the way he wants, he gets very vocal that way too and just starts like arguing with people on his team. And you can see his team like disintegrate as he does that, and they just start to get blown out. And so one of the things that happened is, I am a peacemaker. So one of his teammates quit midway through, so I jumped in the game to give him their fifth person. So I jumped in, calmed everybody down, and kept telling him to shut his mouth, like just shut up. And then I kept telling everyone, just play, just check in, just do what you need to do. And he kept trying to talk, I was like, be quiet, just be quiet. And we got back in the game, they were down like 13, I think, at the time. We lost by one at the end. And I pull him to the side afterwards, and this is what the reason I bring this up as a peacemaker. I pull him to the side afterwards, I just said, hey, let's call him Francis, because his name isn't Francis. But I was like, hey, Francis, I was like, here's just something you need to know. You're the best player on that team, but when you start getting upset with everyone like that, your team melts down every single time. This is like a regular thing that happens. You got to learn how to calm yourself and calm the guys down, and being an encouragement to them and stuff. I said, did you see how the team shifted when I came in and just shut your mouth and calmed everyone? He's like, yeah. And I'm like, you got to learn how to do that, because how you react affects others around you. And so you have to find a way to do that. And that being peacemaking is, it wasn't about me, it was about helping him learn how to do that. And that's what a peacemaker does in our world, is you see people that you have to help them learn how to control their tempers without complaining as well. All right? So Zach Williams basically throws out all these traits and says, I want to be a little bit more like this. And then he says this, it's a great line. He says, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. A little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Okay? And I would say this. This is a great prayer to pray every day. Okay? Honestly. To wake up every day and just say, hey, God, let me be a little bit more like Jesus today and less like me. What a great prayer that is. In Ephesians chapter 4, it says this, since you have heard about Jesus and you have learned the truth that comes from him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and your attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. Okay? Be a little bit more like Jesus, a little less like me. Then he says this, and he's kind of confirming what that scripture says. He says, yeah, there's no denying I have changed because I've been saved from who I used to be. And those of you that are Christians here that, again, you didn't grow up in the church, but you became Christians later, hopefully you can say the same thing about you, is there's no denying God's done some miraculous work in changing who you are. I look back at my life over the last 25 years now since becoming a follower, and I look at it and go, it's amazing who God has slowly transformed me into over that 25 years because I've allowed him to work. And Zach Williams is kind of saying the same thing, is even though I'm saying I want to be a little bit more like Jesus, a little less like me, doesn't mean God hasn't done some work in me already. It's just a continual thing I want to see him continue to do in me. He goes on to say this. He says, but even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see, when I just can't see past myself. And what he's making a point here is this. Even though he's grown, even though God has transformed him, even on his best days, he's humble enough to realize I don't see people the way God does. I don't see people with the eyes that Jesus does. And he's being humble, and hopefully we all understand that, as even on your best days, when you do your greatest work, where you're like, man, that was a good day where I actually was who God wanted me to be. Even on that best day, you're still not Jesus. And so our goal is still to always be like him, because our problem is a selfishness will always seep in. That's going to be a continual thing until we leave this world. That's going to be an issue we have, is putting ourselves before others and worrying about ourselves above everyone else. And that's always going to be something that we struggle with. Then it goes back to the song, and these are parts you've heard, but I want to reread them. He says, "O Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me." Then he says, "Oh, I want to feed the beggar on the street, love to be your hands and feet, freely give what I receive, Lord, help me be." And then he says, "I want to put you first above all else, love my neighbor as myself. In the moments no one sees, Lord, help me be." Okay? Now, I highlighted one little line in there, which is this: "In the moments no one sees." And this is key for a reason. This is where you see your integrity. Okay? It's in the moments that no other human being sees where you can really define your integrity and what's really happening on the inside of you and how much is transforming you. That is when you know what work God is doing in you. When there is no reward other than knowing that you have pleased God, you find out what your real motivation is. All right? So like I said before, it's very easy to deceive others. But when you're on your own, what do? When no one else can reward you or praise you or clap for you, but you're on your own and you have to make decisions and you know no human being is ever going to have a consequence to that or a praise, what do you still do? Do you do what pleases God or do you do what pleases you? And I highlight that line because it's so important to understand your integrity and what God is doing. It's the way to get a benchmark of how willing are you to follow Christ? How much of a real relationship is it versus how much is it where I'm just trying to conform my life to the rules others have for me so that they think something about me, but it's not really who I am on the inside. All right? And then the song says this at the end. It says, "A little more of living everything I preach, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me, oh, a little less like me." And here's what I would encourage you today is this. Make that your prayer for the week. All right? Make that your prayer for the week. Every day, just be a little more like Jesus and a little less like you. Not because you're horrible, not because you're worthless, but Jesus is so much more. So to be a little bit more like Jesus, a little less like us. It's only at that point can we live out God's desires for us that we read in Matthew chapter 5, 14 through 16. It simply says this. Jesus says, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father." Okay? Here's the deal. We will never achieve that scripture in our life if it's about us being us. All right? The only way we will ever achieve that is if we allow God's Spirit to transform us from the inside out. And we start becoming a little bit more like Jesus and a little less like us every single day. If we put that into practice and we use that as a prayer and we really strive for that, that scripture will start to define our life more and more and more, where we can truly say we are the light of the world for the kingdom of God. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father,